Okay, this first section now that we're going to go through is the summary statement. So really, the way I see it is how to pass the Viva before you've even begun. The summary statement is all about simplifying complex situations, thinking like a boss, and trying to predict the direction of the Viva before it's even begun. The Viva has changed a lot. So like a lot of things in life, things can become cliches, and that's completely fine. So back in the day, the Viva stem would be something very general, and a summary statement would be something that was really, really useful to say just to show that you understood and you got what this Viva was about. But the Viva's definitely changed. So I'm gonna completely contradict myself and tell you that there's very little space to state a summary statement at the start of your Viva. So I just wanna repeat that. You'll get a question, a stem that's very specific, 55-year-old female for a lap collie with hypertension in the pre-admission clinic. What are the causes of hypertension? It'd be very illogical for you to start stating a summary statement when there's a direct question of what are the causes of hypertension. That said, I think there's still value in it. So whereas I'm saying you should just go ahead and mention the cause of hypertension, what I do in that first couple of minutes of pre-reading is I just write out this summary statement because I'm trying to identify and prime my brain to think of the major issues, whether they're stated or not. And that's what we'll go through in this exercise. So you might say, where on earth will I actually use this summary statement while we're practicing it? This is going to be simply a drill of trying to predict what are the priorities or what are the critical issues or points of difference in this case. And imagine, even though the first stem might be very specific, there'll often come a time in the Viva where you're talking with the examiner and you both don't really understand what each other's saying. Maybe you've missed a point. And I think this is a really good spot for something like a summary statement where you can just say, look, I'm not exactly sure if I'm giving you the right answer or exactly sure what you're saying, but I think that this is the situation. I believe these things are very important in this situation and this is what I'm going to do. So I think it does help you to identify some very important issues regardless. So that said, let's get into some of these exercises. So firstly, what are the magic words? So age and gender, obvious risk stratification tools that, you know, primes our mind to think of specific disease and progresses in the operating theater and anesthesia. Risk level, high or low. And just to point out that this isn't the ACC, AHA level of risk. This is just your perception of the risk of a situation. And to be honest, you know, this is going to be a Viva where you're going to be tested. Generally speaking, the risk level is going to be high. Is it elective or emergency or urgent surgery or futile? Obviously, really important when you frame things, if it's emergency, you really have to crack on with minimal or fast optimization, whereas elective surgery, you know, you do have time for optimization. Finally, the critical issue. And this is just a really, you know, 3 points, maybe two, about what you think is most important about the situation that you believe the Viva is going to try to use to discriminate against, you know, between candidates. And we'll go into that in a second as well. Finally, something we haven't often had to you know, think about in our tertiary hospital practice, as most anaesthetic trainees are in, is the location of hospital and theatre. And just remembering that ANZCA needs to get people accredited, understanding that most anaesthetists are probably going to work in small private hospitals scattered across the country. So appreciating the location is really important. Finally, who do I need? So what I might get you guys to do right now is just take a minute or two to write down a wish list. Who are all the people you refer to, all the common things you might need in an emergency, in various specialty assistants. Think of obstetrics and pediatrics and, AAAs and what you do for that. And just take a couple of minutes and I'll just ask someone to run through as the first activity. So take a couple of minutes now.
Hematologist, cardiologist, cardiothoracic surgeon, radiologist, that's probably all I wrote down.
Yeah, sounds good. And when I think of hematologist, I try to bundle things a lot in whatever I'm thinking about. For example, if I think of hematologist, I'm thinking blood loss, right? And who else might you need in a blood loss case that you could just rattle off pretty quickly?
So you definitely need more hands on deck.
Yep.
So in terms of technicians and nurses to check and administer blood, you may need a second anaesthetist so that you can have someone as a hands-off leader. And the surgeon, obviously, to fix the bleeding. And radiologist is the other thought.
And the other one, I think, with blood is like blood bank, perfusionist, cell saver. as a bit of a bundle of care as well.
Other people I'd want would be post-op for ICU care. I would consider if there was peri-op optimization, so from cardiologist, endocrine, and then if there was an obstetric emergency, you'd want your obstetric, your obs, midwives, pediatricians, and potentially NICU.
Yeah, fantastic. So in my mind, I'm grouping these things. That there's kind of the blood loss stuff, there's pediatric obstetric stuff, and then there's all the specialists that I would refer to. And the reason I say this is definitely when I was going through, I felt like for some reason I had to know everything about every specialty. And we often feel that we need that kind of level of expertise. But I guess I want to give you the confidence that if at this stage you're not aware of something, you probably need to refer it up. And that's probably a very safe thing to do in the exam. If you feel like you don't know the area particularly well, it is time to refer that across. And that's mainly the reason why we go through that. Let's get onto the actual exercise. So you read the Viva stem, you panic a little, then you say something like, this is an elderly male for a high-risk emergency procedure in a patient with critical cardiac disease requiring tertiary level care and input from cardiology and ICU post-op as an example. So what I'll get everyone to do, so this is the first case. Robert is a 74-year-old male with a ruptured AAA for laparotomy who's rushed into the ED by ambulance. Past history, usual stuff, vascular disease, stents, hypertension, and a blood pressure of 85/40. So I want you guys to take 30 seconds now, take it in turns, and just talk to your partner, and literally go through that format of age, gender, elective emergency, risk level, a couple of critical issue points that you think are the most important things about the situation, and your ideal location, and if you need anyone else. This should be a quick sentence, so it doesn't have to be a whole spiel. Take 30 seconds now.
So this is an elderly gentleman who's high risk with a ruptured AAA, which is an emergency life-saving procedure. His critical issue is hypovolemic shock related to blood loss. He's not in theatre at the moment, but needs to be rushed to a vascular theatre, so potentially a combined theatre location. I'm going to need additional anaesthetic assistance, probably a second anaesthetist, a massive transfusion protocol with assistance from the lab, additional anaesthetic nurses, and probably a sedalist as well as a vascular surgeon.
Yeah, fantastic. So I completely agree. I like that you were very brief, you know, elderly male, high-risk emergency procedure, and I agree with your dominant patient issue. There's obviously so many things that you need to think about, but in real life, when you're in this case, all I care about is getting that cross clamp on, right? So it's all about transfer to theatre, and that's its own task in itself. The cardiovascular instability and the fact that you'll need a reasonable transfusion. Again, I've mentioned here, your situation may be vague from the stem, so I just use phrases like, this should ideally be done in a tertiary hospital, so I'm thinking of that. And also having all your supports, vascular surgeon, blood bank, ICU perfusionist, cell saver, hematologist. I've said something that I'll just mention to now. I've said cardiovascular instability, or I'm prepared for that. Just to make sure that you realize that if I do say something that's vague like that, I can easily and quickly follow it up in the exam with more detail. For example, to say someone has a hemodynamically stable induction gives the examiner no real information of what you know about what this hemodynamics should be or how you'll achieve that. So I just want to make mention that you don't want to say vague terms or cliches, but if you do, you can follow that up quickly with more detail about what that means. So I just want to give a bit of a mention that this is generally about giving yourself an ability to understand what the whole environment is. So Shelley, 50-year-old female, presents with a grade 3 subarachnoid hemorrhage to a small suburban hospital with no neurosurgery, and you're asked to assess her.
So here we've got a 50-year-old lady who's at high risk of deterioration, who's presented for an emergency procedure at a hospital which is not optimized to deal with her, given that it does not have neurosurgery. A dominant patient issue is to be able to adequately mitigate the risk of rapidly rising intracranial pressure and transfer her to a safe location. The people that I would specifically need would be the team to stabilize her, which would include critical care physicians like the intensivists, as well as a second anaesthetist or a senior trainee. I would need to rapidly engage services of a transport service, as well as a receiving tertiary centre that does have neurosurgery. I would also like to have a neurosurgical team on the phone to give advice, as well as the receiving anaesthetist to to be able to specifically direct pre-optimization.
Yeah, that sounds great. So, and I'll just give you my answer for that. 50-year-old female, urgent high-risk condition. And I've just very broadly said dominant patient issue is complex neurosurgical pathology. Depending on the situation and the question and what the examiner is saying, I might go into the detail of preventing rupture, cerebral perfusion, ICP issues. And just to know that I have that ability to go through that. And I've just said recurring transfer to center with neurosurgical services and post-op care. And one important thing to mention, you know, Harsh mentioned that he's kind of doing this on the fly. I think it's really important to be able to do that because while the stem gives you 2 minutes of prep time, most of all, most of this viva is going to be you thinking and talking out through situations in a reasonable manner on the fly. So I think it's really important to be able to, you know, be able to do that and think about, you know, good answers to complex situations. Next case, 30-year-old female, G1, P0, 29 weeks, presents to the labor ward with a blood pressure.